name is Shane, and it's an honor to be with you. And I just want to kind of, first of all, tell you about my primary ministry, my most important ministry, and that's my family. I have a beautiful wife named Casey, and next week we celebrate being married 11 years. And yeah, praise the Lord for that. Yeah, she gets a purple heart for that. Praise the Lord. And I love my wife. She is a great woman, a godly woman. She has the spiritual gift of hotness. That's a good thing, you know, and praise the Lord for that. And then we have three beautiful kiddos. Our oldest is our daughter, Reagan. She is 9, and she is a redhead, so that tells you a lot right there. Amen. And then our middle is our daughter, Harper. She is 4, and she is a prayer request. And then our youngest is our son, Titus. He is 2.5, and we adopted him from Uganda, Africa. So that's our family. And so greetings from them, and it's an honor to be with you this morning. And I want to tell you, church, it's such an honor, and just to see the Lord move. And we saw many decisions Wednesday night at chapel, and then even this morning in the first service and the Quarries Church. And it's an honor to be with you here. And I want to tell you, I love your leadership. I love your staff. And over the last couple of months, I've just grown to adore your pastor, Dr. Bowman. And the Bible tells us to honor those men who are faithful to the Lord and faithful to the Word. So don't we appreciate Dr. Bowman and his ministry? And so thankful for him. And so it is an honor to be with you. If you have your Bibles, and I hope that you do, if you'll turn to Philippians chapter 1. Philippians chapter 1. And Philippians chapter 1 is right before Philippians chapter 2. Does that help anybody? Yeah. All right. Good deal. You know, when I was growing up in church, my pastor was an older man, and he used to say, "It warms my heart to hear the rustling of Bible pages." And times have changed. So I want to tell you this morning, it warms my soul to see the soft glow of your phone on your face as you scroll through to find your Bible. And I'm just going to assume you're not on Facebook or Twitter, all right? I'm going to assume you're looking at God's Word, all right? I'm watching you up there, balcony. I can see you up there, all of you up there. I see you. All right. Well, it's an honor to be here. Do you like to have a good time in church? Is that okay if we have a good time this morning? Are y'all okay with that? Well, let's talk. All right, let's talk. Philippians chapter 1. And so I'm going to talk to you this morning, and it's very simple, and it's this. I want to encourage you this morning to pursue joy over happiness. See, the world tells us we need to be happy, happy, happy. And the problem with happiness is this, is that happiness comes from the word happenstance, that comes from the word circumstance. So what that says is your happiness is directly tied to your circumstance. The problem with that is happiness is dictated by outward things, and the problem with outward things and circumstances is they change all the time. See, if everything's going your way, you can be happy. If you wake up in the morning and you're having a good hair day, you're happy. If your boss praises you, you're happy. If your kids ain't acting a fool, you're happy. But the problem with happiness is that happiness can leave with a phone call. Yesterday, I watched one of my best friends, after getting a phone call to come to the hospital, I watched one of my best friends go off into eternity dying from an inoperable brain tumor. That's not happy. But the great thing about joy, church, is that joy is not built on outward circumstances. Joy is on the inside, and joy is not built on circumstances. Joy is built on a person, and that person has a name. Therefore, joy has a name, and that name is Jesus. Amen? So why don't you turn to your neighbor and say, "We're going to talk about Jesus this morning." Tell them that. All right, come on now, church. Say it with some soul. We're going to have some church up in here. Say, "We're going to talk about Jesus this morning." All right? I don't know about you, church, but you can tell I like to get a little excited. Is that okay? You know, we can get real excited about the Cowboys and the Texans, and we know they're going to lose. So we ought to be able to get excited about Jesus. He always wins, all right? So I'll make a deal with you this morning, church. For every amen, praise the Lord, clap I hear, I'll take 30 seconds off the sermon. How about that? Amen? Yeah, there you go. How many of you say, "You know what? I've had some good days." Raise your hand. Any good days? How many of you ever had a bad day? Ever had a bad day? It reminded me of a guy that went to the doctor. He was having a bad day, and the doctor goes, "Hey, listen, friend, I I got bad news for you, and I got really bad news for you. And the guy goes, well, gosh, I guess give me the bad news first. And the doctor goes, well, the bad news is you have 24 hours to live. And the guy goes, well, it gets worse than that. What's the really bad news? And the doctor goes, I meant to call you yesterday. No, that's a bad day. Or maybe you're like the other guy. I don't know if you saw him on the news. The guy was pumping gas, and he removed the nozzle to put it back, and he squirted gas down his arm, and he got in the car, started driving down the highway, and he lit a cigarette, and ash from a cigarette fell on his arm, and his arm caught on fire. So as he's driving down the road, he sticks his arm out the window, waving it up and down, trying to put it out, and he got pulled over and got arrested for waving a firearm, you know? Like, that's a bad day. So this morning, Paul's going to talk to us in the book of Philippians. And this is what Paul says. He's going to write about joy. Now, church, what's interesting about that is you need to understand the background to really appreciate what Paul's saying. When Paul writes this letter, the Philippians, he's writing it to a church in Philippi, and he's writing this letter, watch this, from a jail cell. So this morning, what we're all going to do, because it's our default mode, because we're good at making excuses, we're going to say, well, Paul doesn't know what I'm going through. Listen, Paul's writing this in a jail cell. And Paul's in prison for preaching the gospel. Now, I don't know if anybody in this room's ever been put in prison for preaching the gospel, but there's where Paul is, and he's still talking about joy. So this is what takes place. Paul's preaching the gospel. He gets arrested. He gets taken to Rome. He puts in house arrest and prison for preaching the gospel, and he's waiting his trial, and Paul has a Roman soldier chained to him 24 hours a day, 7 days a week. These Roman soldiers would take 12-hour shifts, so Paul would be chained to a Roman soldier. So if Paul had a visitor, Roman soldier. While Paul was eating, Roman soldier. While Paul was drinking, Roman soldier. While Paul was sleeping, Roman soldier. While Paul went to the restroom, Roman soldier. I don't know if it was worse for Paul or the Roman soldier, you know what I mean? But he's in a bad circumstance. And this is what had been easy for Paul to do. God, I was doing right, and you put me here. God, I was doing what I was supposed to, and I got arrested. Really, God? God, I quit. I give up. This is bull. God, no way. This is not fair. How many of you have ever known people, maybe you've been there yourself, where you stopped following the Lord because you didn't get your way, or you know people that way? God, this isn't fair. See, Paul didn't do that. He talked about joy because joy was not built on circumstances. Joy was on the inside, and his joy had a name, and that name was what, church? Jesus. And remember, and Paul writes this, so Philippi sends a love offering to him, and so he writes this letter back as a thank you note to the church, but in there, he's going to talk about joy. I'm going to take an opportunity to tell them, thank you for the love offering, but my joy is not built on this material thing, or my hope is not in these circumstances. I'm going to tell you about joy who's built on Jesus. So look at what he says. We're going to have fun this morning, church. Look at Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. If you're with me, say, uh-huh. Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. Here we go. Let's look at this. Philippians chapter 1, verse 12. He goes, I want you to know, brothers, what has happened to me has really served to advance the gospel. Well, church, what happened to him? He got arrested. And you'll go, well, how's that served to advance the gospel? Like, him in a prison cell, how does that advance the gospel? Well, Paul's going to tell us. Look at verse 13. Look at what he says. So that it has become known throughout the whole imperial guard and to all the rest that my imprisonment is for Christ. Well, how did that happen? Listen, Paul could have focused on his circumstances and given up, but Paul looked at joy. Look at this. So Paul, for several years now, has been praying to be able to share the gospel to Roman soldiers. So Jesus goes, I'm going to answer your prayer. Now watch this. Paul could have given up. But this is what Paul does. I want you to imagine this. He says, the gospel has gone forth amongst the imperial guard. So Paul's in prison. This is what he does. Paul looks down at his wrist, and on his wrist he sees a shackle. And connected to that shackle, he sees chain links. And at the other end of those chain links, he sees another shackle that's around the wrist of a Roman soldier. And so he looks at his wrist, he looks at that chain, he looks at the Roman soldier's wrist, he looks at the Roman soldier's wrist, and he looks at the chain, he looks back at his wrist, and he goes, wait a minute, ha ha, I'm not chained to him, that sucker's chained to me. Hey brother, have you heard about Jesus? And they start getting saved. Why? Because Paul's joy is not on circumstances. His joy is on the inside. And his joy has a name, and his name is Jesus. And so if you want to say it like this, God is in the cell with him, and God is working through him. And those brothers start getting saved. Look at verse 14. And most of the brothers, having become confident in the Lord by my imprisonment, are much more bold to speak the word without fear. So not only is Paul sharing the gospel, he's emboldening others, because the church and others are looking at Paul and goes, man, if that brother can do it in prison, how much more can we do it as free men and women? Wow. Have you ever thought how many opportunities, church, that we miss because we're so busy focusing on our circumstances that we totally miss what God's trying to do in our life? I want you to think about this. Your coworkers, your neighbors, the students you go to school with, your friends, many of them, your life is the only Bible they're reading. And they're watching how we operate in the middle of suffering. They're watching how we operate in the middle of trials and tribulations. They're watching how we operate in the middle of our circumstances. And it's easy for all of us to focus on our circumstance so much we miss Jesus. I'm gonna give you an example. I want you to think about a quarter. A quarter is less than an inch wide. The sun, S-U-N, is 93 million miles wide. Now, we could go out on this beautiful sunny Sunday morning, and we could take a quarter that's less than an inch wide, and we could place it right in front of our face and focus on it just enough that we can completely block out the sun, S-U-N. Even though the sun is much bigger and much more powerful than that quarter, we can focus on that quarter just enough that we completely block out the sun, S-U-N. You know, we can do the same thing in our circumstances. We can focus on our circumstance so much that we completely block out the sun, S-O-N, and totally miss him, even though he's bigger and more powerful than our circumstance. So if you're writing anything down, write this down. If you cheated and you're scrolling through Facebook, go ahead and post this. Truth right here. See, we always tell God how big our problems are. And we always tell Jesus how big our circumstance is. But when's the last time we told our problems and our circumstances how big our Jesus is? And he focused on the truth of joy, because joy was on the inside, and joy has a name. And his name is what, church? Jesus. Turn to Philippians 4. So Paul starts this letter with joy. He ends it with joy. And listen what he says in Philippians 4. So in Philippians 4, verse 4, we're about to have some fun with this, church. All right, here we go. Philippians 4, verse 4, he says this. Rejoice in the Lord sometimes. Is that what yours says? Rejoice in the Lord when everything goes your way. Rejoice in the Lord when you get a raise. Is that what it says? What does it say? Rejoice in the Lord what? Always. And then he says this. In case you didn't catch it the first time, let me tell you one more time. Again, I will say what? Rejoice. Now, I want you to notice what Paul does here. From a prison cell, he doesn't say, hey, rejoice if you feel like it. Hey, rejoice if everything goes your way. Rejoice in the Lord sometimes. What does he say? Rejoice and do it what? Always. So in good days, what are we to do, church? Rejoice. In difficult days, what are we to do? Rejoice. In times of plenty, what are we to do? In times when the bottom falls out, what are we to do? Rejoice. Why? Because God is with us, and it's on the inside, and our joy has a name, and it's what? Jesus. So you know what this means? If you notice, it's a command. Notice, it's not if you want to, if you feel like it, or if you choose to. It's a command. He says, rejoice in the Lord always. And again, I say rejoice. It's a command. So watch this, church. Don't lose me. Watch this. It's a command. Therefore, if we are not joyful people, we are actually in sin. I want us to talk about that for a minute, church. Because sometimes the most miserable people in the world sit in church pews every Sunday. And we just walk in looking like we're angry at the world. Look like we've been sucking on a sour pickle all morning. We walk in just angry. God is good. All the time, God is good. Really? Because you look miserable. Therefore, your God must be miserable. Isn't that what it tells the world? We can focus on difficulty. We can focus on negativity, and that's what we're going to run into. Reminds me of my cousin Kaylee. When she was 9, she wanted me to teach her how to ride her bicycle without training wheels. I was 16, so I said, all right, cool. So I pick her up, I throw her bicycle in the back of my truck, and we go down to Lorena High School. I grew up in a small town south of Waco, Lorena. So we go to Lorena High School on Saturday morning, empty parking lot, not a soul in sight, not a car in sight beside my truck, wide open parking lot. So I get her bike out, and I said, all right, Kaylee, here's the game plan. Are you ready? And she goes, uh-huh. And I go, okay, here's the deal. I'm going to put your helmet on. We're going to put your elbow pads and knee pads on. I'm going to take your training wheels off. I'm going to put you on the bicycle. You're going to start pedaling, and I'm going to run next to you. I'm going to hold you up, and I'm going to go faster, and you're going to pedal faster. And then when you're ready, I'm just going to shoot you on your way, and you just ride in open freedom. You're going to just soar like an eagle. Are you ready to do that? And she goes, no. And I go, why? And she goes, there's a pole right there. Now, church, wide open parking lot. I mean, huge, wide open. And in that parking lot was one light pole. And I go, girl, just go to the left, go to the right, go right down the middle. Go anywhere. Just avoid that pole, wide open. She goes, I'm going to hit that pole. And I go, no, you're not. She goes, yes, I am. And I go, no, you're not. Let's go. And so I just take off running. I go, pedal, pedal. She goes, uh-uh. And I go, pedal. She starts pedaling. I go, are you ready? She goes, no. Are you ready? No. Are you ready? No. And I go, good, go. And she pedals, church. I kid you not. She pedaled and made a beeline straight for that pole, smacked it, fell over. And I go, oh, gosh, I'm in trouble, you know? Now, church, why did she go to the pole? What was she focusing on? A pole. You know any negative people? Do you know any negative people? It's too hot. It's too cold. The carpet's too green. The music's too loud. The music's not loud enough. The preacher didn't notice my new dress. You know any negative people like that? Hey, some of you are pointing. Stop pointing, all right? And sometimes if we go through life looking for poles, we're going to find poles. You ever know people that go through life like this? Well, there's a pole. Up, there's a pole. Up, here's a pole. There's a pole. Here's a pole. Everywhere a pole, pole. Do you know those people? It's just very confusing to the world that we say we're a people of joy. Look at verse 5. Why is this important? Because the world is watching us, church. Let your reasonableness be known to what, church? Everyone. Why do we let that be known? Because people are going to ask you. They're like, man, where's your joy come from? How are you able to do that? How are you able to have that attitude? How are you able to have that peace? Like, your world is falling apart. You're literally going through hell. How is that happening? And you go, let me tell you about my joy. Because my joy has a name, and his name is what, church? Jesus. He goes, let me tell you about my joy and the reason of my joy. And then these next 5 words here I love, church. Underline those. Highlight those, circle those, kiss it, star it, tattoo it on your forehead, whatever you got to do. Look at this. The Lord is at what? Hand. That's what he says. The reasonableness for my joy is that Jesus is here. And my God is here. My God is bigger and stronger and better than any of these circumstances. And I know from God's word that I can trust him because he's doing all things for his glory and my good. Look at verse 6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, meaning depend upon the Lord. You know what praying is? Praying is this, saying, God, I desperately need you. You know what not praying is? We make excuses. Well, I'm too busy, or I'm just not good at praying. You know what it really is? When we're not praying, we are declaring our independence from God. God, I got this. God, I can handle this. I don't need you on this one, bud. God, I can do this. I'm my own man. I got a beard and I grill my own steaks. I got this. How's that working for you? I'm dependent upon the Lord because he is my joy. And do not be anxious about anything. Now, I'm not going to talk about clinical anxiety or clinical depression. That's a whole different ballgame. I'm going to talk about your daily average worrying, anxiety, stress, depression. How many of you say, man, that hinders, I get stressed, I worry, get anxious? Raise your hand. Yeah, if you're not raising your hand, you're just lying. That's all of us, right? Let me ask you another question that correlates with that, believe it or not. How many of you would consider yourself a control freak? You got to be in control. It's got to be your way. You got to do it. Raise your hand. Once again, you're not raising your hand, you're lying. All right, we're all lying here. You know why we get anxious and worry and get stressed out? Because we're trying to control things. We want to do it our way. We want it done our way. It's got to be this way. I can do it. I can pull myself by my own bootstraps. I can white knuckle this thing. And we get stressed out, we get anxious, and we worry. You know why? Because controlling things is God's job, not ours. And so when we're struggling, most of the time, it's because we're trying to do a job that's way above our pay grade. At the end of the day, church, our only job is to trust Jesus to do his job, and he's very, very good at his job. So take it to Jesus, because he is our joy. Look at verse 7. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts. And look at this. And your minds in Christ. I love that part. Underline that. Which surpasses all understanding. Listen, faith is not understanding everything. We pray, God, I just want to understand. Listen, that's not faith. Faith is not getting God to do what you want him to. Man, if I just have enough faith, then God will do what I want him to. Isn't that what TV preachers tell us a lot of times? Brother, you just got to wake up in the morning, put a smile on your face, go and look at yourself in the mirror and go, you're a champion in your reflection and go, yes, you are. And then God's, I'm never going to get sick and I'm going to have money in the bank account and I'm going to walk into my job and they're just going to sing like angels. Whoa, he's finally here. Your kids are always going to act right. That's not faith. You know what faith is? Faith is this. God, I don't get it. I don't understand it. Heck, I may not even like it. But God, I trust you because you're God. I'll tell you, if it's okay, if I can just be a moment of vulnerability and transparent with you, our youngest son is in a wheelchair. We adopted him from Uganda. We knew he had some special needs. We didn't know the severity of it until we got home and got him around healthcare here and into our hospitals here, and what we have found out is our son actually has epilepsy. And when we first brought him home, church, he was having 15 to 17 seizures a day. He's had surgery after surgery after surgery. We've seen this little man suffer. He's been through more in 2 years than most of us be in our life. His mom died during childbirth. His dad was a Muslim man with already four other women and didn't want him. But we've seen God move. We believe that God's healing him. Now he may have one seizure a day. But we don't know. Like doctors tell, they can't really tell us because he's still developing. And so they literally tell us this, your son Titus may run up and down a basketball court one day, or y'all may never be empty nesters. So we're just trusting the Lord. Church, when we try to look a year down the road, 5 years down the road, 10 years down the road, we get anxious and stressed. So we're just saying, Lord, we trust you today and we know you're good today. Amen. The Lord has used that young man. Listen, church, the last 2 years have been by far the most difficult 2 years of our lives, but have been by far the best 2 years of our lives. The Lord has used this young man and his suffering to make me a better man, to make me a better husband, to make my wife a better wife and a better woman, to make our kids better. And so people ask us this question. This is where I'm going with it, church. People ask us this question all the time. If you knew then what you know now about him, would you have still adopted him? And the spiritual answer would be go, yes, because I'm super Christian. But the honest truth is, who I was 2 years ago And if I knew then what I know now, the answer would probably be no, we wouldn't have. Just being honest. But thank God he didn't consult with me because he knew what was better. And we have absolute joy. And we love our son, and we love him equally as our biological daughters. And he's our son, and he's been the greatest thing in our life. It's joy in the midst of suffering, because our joy has a name, and his name is what? Jesus. Now look at verse 10. We kind of land this plane. You know what it means when a preacher says he's almost done? Nothing at all. All right, so here we go. Verse 10. I rejoiced in the Lord greatly that now at length you have revived your concern for me, and you were indeed concerned for me, but you had no opportunity. What he's saying is like, I got your love offering. Thank you so much. I am overwhelmed by your love offering. But he's going to take it as an opportunity to say, hey, thank you for the love offering. Thank you for the material things. But my joy is not built on those. Let me tell you about my joy. Look at verse 11. Not that I am speaking of being in need, for watch this. This is practical right here, church. Practical. I have learned in whatever situation I am to be what? Underline that. To be what? Content. I know how to be brought low. I know how to abound in every circumstance. Whoa, what have we been talking about? Circumstance. Look, in any and every circumstance, I have learned the secret, underline secret, of facing plenty and hunger, abundance and need. Why? What's the secret? The secret has a name, and it's what? Jesus. The secret is verse 13. Now, listen, verse 13, Philippians 4:13, has to be one of the most misquoted scriptures in all the Bible. Listen, it has nothing to do with dunking a basketball or hitting a home run or getting your way. It has everything to do with being content in every season, in every situation, because you have joy on the inside, and your joy has a name, and it's what? Jesus. That's what 13's all about. Look at it. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Notice, it's not even you doing it, it's him who strengthens you. Why can you do all things in every season, in every circumstance? Why can you do all things? Because Jesus can do all things, and he will do it through you. Jesus is our joy. So let's talk. Here becomes the so what side of it. If you notice, in none of these verses does it talk about how great we are or how awesome we are. This is what culture says. You're so awesome. Really? According to the Bible, without Jesus, I was born dead, lost, an orphan, a temple of idols, and a sinner. That sounds really awesome. We're not awesome, but our Jesus is very awesome. So I need you to turn to your neighbor, and as lovingly and kindly as you can, tell them right now, go say this, you are not awesome. Tell them that. They need to hear it. Tell them. Now, some of you, that felt way too good to say. Not awesome. We're not. Now, watch this progression. Our Jesus is very awesome. And then this confuses people. In fact, do this today. You want to do something fun? When you get home, because I know you're not looking at it now, but when you get home and you get on Facebook and Twitter and Instagram and all those things, or maybe you don't have those, you're probably better off. But if you do, put this. I am not awesome. And watch people freak out. So I told our church to do it several months back, and people did. And I think of a guy named Jason in our early service. He went in and put, I am not awesome, on his Facebook. And then here came all the trolls. And they're like, who would ever tell you that? You are awesome. Who would ever tell you that? And he goes, my pastor did. You know, like, and tag me in it. Thanks, Jason. We're not awesome. Watch this. I was lost, met Jesus. Now I'm found. He's awesome. I was a temple of idols, met Jesus. Now I'm a temple of the Holy Spirit. He's awesome. I was an orphan, met Jesus. Now I'm a child of the King. He's awesome. I was dead, met Jesus. Now I'm alive. He's awesome. Jesus isn't about making good people better. He's about making dead people alive. Amen? He's very awesome. And culture says, oh, you're awesome. What about this? This is off script. Let's just talk about this. This is fine. Culture says, you know what you need to do? At the end of the day, balcony, you just need to follow your heart. Just follow your heart. Let's talk about that. Heart comes from the Greek word cardia. It's where we get the word cardiologist from, which is a heart, what? Doctor. And cardia is the seat of our emotions. So our heart is really our emotions. It's not the organ that pumps blood. It's our emotions. So culture says this, just follow your emotions. Whatever feels right, just do whatever feels right. How does that work for you? We follow our emotions and feelings right into a ditch every day, don't we? Don't follow our heart. Follow Jesus. And we let Jesus lead our heart. What about this? Oh, honey boo-boo child. You know what you need to do? Just believe in yourself. You just need to believe in yourself. Listen, the most sanctified Texas word I can think of that is bull hockey. Because we have two great enemies. And it's not the guy who stole our girlfriend in seventh grade. It's not our rival school. Like, I grew up in Lorena. We had a rival school that hated Robinson Rockets. In fact, we had a chant for Robinson and went like this. 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, Robinson women look like men. That was our chant. We couldn't stand them. Couldn't stand them. Couldn't stand them. But that's not our enemy. We have a very real enemy who is out to kill, steal, and destroy you. Satan. He's out to kill your ministry. He's out to kill your testimony. He's out to kill your marriage. He's out to kill your kids and destroy them all. But we have a second great enemy. You know who that is? Ourself. Listen, friend, no one's lied to me more than I've lied to myself. No one's discouraged me more than I've discouraged myself. No one's harder on me than I'm harder on myself. No one's deceived me more than I've deceived myself. So I don't need to believe in myself. Jesus said this, you need to deny yourself, pick up your cross, and follow me. So we deny ourselves. Why? Because Jesus is great, and Jesus is awesome, and he is the source of our joy, because our joy has a name, and that name is what? Jesus. We're not awesome. He is. Let me tell you about some awesome things he did. See, God created us. Sin separated us. But 2,000 years ago, Jesus, the Son of God, took a mission trip to planet Earth, and he wrapped on human flesh. And he never stopped being God, but in that moment, he became 100% God, 100% man, to live as a man, to die for mankind. Think about it. Everything that Jesus did was good. He lived a perfect, sin-free life that you and I couldn't live. Think about it. He caused the blind to see. He caused the deaf to hear. He caused the handicapped to get up and run. How many of you are glad there's no handicapped parking in heaven? Are you glad about that? Caused the mute to shout praises to God. He walked on water. He calmed the storm. He fed over 5,000 with 2 fish sandwiches. Listen, Subway has nothing on that brother. And at 33 years old, he climbed on top of a cross that was our cross. He was sinless. We are sinful. So when they shoved a crown of thorns on his head, they should have done that to me. When they spit in his face, they should have done that to you. When they opened up his back, they should have done that to us. When they nailed him to a cross, they should have done that to us. But Jesus, God, the most famous one of all, took our place. He is our joy. And he died there. And they took his lifeless body off that old rugged cross, and they put him in a borrowed grave. And church, you know why they put him in a borrowed grave? Because he wasn't going to stay there long, baby. Because 3 days later, he did what Buddha did not do, what Muhammad did not do, what Joseph Smith of Mormonism did not do. Jesus busted out of the grave, conquering sin, death, and Satan. And he showed himself, showing that God the Father literally accepted God the Son's sacrifice on our behalf. He is our joy. And he showed himself for 40 days, showing that he had literally overcame the grave. You know what I love about those 40 days, church, is on 2 different occasions, it says Jesus cooked breakfast for the disciples. My only question is this, how good were those eggs? Like, I'm just gonna rub them on my face. The resurrected Jesus cooked these, you know? And then at the end of 40 days, he climbs on top of a mountain called Olive, and right before his disciples, he ascends into heaven like a bottle rocket. Boom! Goes through the gates of pearl, down the streets of gold, through the singing angels and the bowing elders, and he sat down at the right hand of the Father on a throne because he is the King of all kings. And why did he sit down, church? Not because he was tired, not because he was famished, not because he needed a Starbucks break. He sat down because three very important words he said on the cross. It is what? Finished. But that's not the end of the story. Because one day, the trumpet's going to blast, the angel's going to shout, and Jesus is coming back for his church. Do you believe that? People ask all the time, when is he coming back? I don't know. But one thing I do know is today is a heck of a lot closer than yesterday was. He's coming back for the church. I love what one pastor said. The angel Gabriel's going to toot, and we're going to scoot. That's cool. I like that. So what's the church? Is it this building? I ask people all the time, are you a Christian? And they'll say, yeah. I go, well, how do you know? And they go, oh, well, I go to such and such church down the road. What that means, they go to some building with a cross on the side or a steeple on top, but they're sitting inside of this great, but this is a wonderful building, but does sitting inside of here make you a Christian? Just like sitting inside of Taco Bell is not going to make you a burrito. We understand that, right? Jesus makes people Christians. And it's not about you being in the building. It's about Jesus being in you. So what does it mean to be the church? It's for anyone who is who repents and believes. What does it mean to repent? D.L. Moody said, we are born with our backs towards God, and we spend our life walking away from him, doing our own thing, doing what we believe is right. What we do is we believe in ourselves and follow our heart and think we're awesome. And then at some point, hopefully the gospel permeates us, or we hear something like we're hearing today, and we have a change of mind, a change of heart, and we go, oh, I'm going the wrong way. Man, I'm trusting in happiness, and this is killing me. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I am weary. I'm done. And we turn from that, and we turn to true joy, which is Jesus. And we place our faith and our trust in Jesus. Not just what he did 2,000 years ago, but for every day for the rest of our life. What's great, Jesus said this, I must go so one equal to me, equivalent to me, can come. And he's talking about the helper, the comforter, the Holy Spirit. When we turn from our way of doing things and we trust Jesus as our Lord and Savior, watch this, God sends his Spirit, the same power that ripped Jesus out of the grave. God sends that not to live around us or above us or under us, but to live where, church? In us. That is the greatest news of the gospel. Not that our sins would be forgiven, that's true. Not that we get to go to heaven one day, that's true. The greatest news of the gospel is that God gives us his very best, which is himself. We get to know God, behold God, trust God, experience God. We get God, the most famous one of all, in us. And when God comes to live in us, he brings us joy. He brings us peace. He brings us love. He brings us himself. Become alive to never die again. It's all about Jesus. Do you know him? Is he your joy? Is all your life point to Jesus? If not, you're missing the purpose of your life. You ever woke up in the morning and stumbled into the bathroom? I'm not a morning person. You're not either. That's why you're at the 11 o'clock service, right? Like, I'm not even a Christian until 8:30, you know what I mean? I try not to get out of bed before the Holy Spirit does. But you ever walked into the restroom and look at your face in the mirror early in the morning, you got bedhead going on, you got pillow grit on your face, got eye crusties and nose crusties, you know what I'm talking about, and you look in the mirror and you get a tear in your face and then it drips down your little porcelain face and then you look and you say, God, why am I here? You're here to know Jesus and to experience Jesus and know that eternal life is now and to have the peace, joy, and love that is Jesus. So if you don't have that, you're missing the reason for your existence. Maybe you're here this morning, you're tired of chasing happiness. and you're weary. And you're sick and tired. Maybe you're here this morning and you're like, man, I'm ready to give up. I'm ready to quit. And my response is good. That's the best place to be. Because now it's time to turn it over to Jesus. If you have your Bibles, turn to the table of contents, and this is where we're done. You're like, that's weird. Hey, I'm weird. Be weird with me. Let's turn to the table of contents. It's all about Jesus. Our joy has a name, and it's Jesus. Church, if you see there in your table of contents, everything points to Jesus. Right there in your table of contents, there's 66 books, 39 Old Testament, 27 New Testament, and they all point to the greatness of Jesus. Would you follow along with me? In Genesis, he's the breath of life. In Exodus, the Passover lamb. In Leviticus, he's our high priest. In Numbers, the fire by night. In Deuteronomy, he's Moses' voice. In Joshua, he's salvation's choice. In Judges, the lawgiver. In Ruth, the kinsman redeemer. In 1 and 2 Samuel, he is our trusted prophet. In 1 and 2 Kings and 1 and 2 Chronicles, he is sovereign. In Ezra, he's the true and faithful scribe. In Nehemiah, he's the rebuilder of broken walls and lives. In Esther, he's Mordecai's courage. In Job, the timeless redeemer. In Psalms, he is our morning song. In Proverbs, he's wisdom's cry. In Ecclesiastes, he's the time and season. In the Song of Solomon, he's the lover's dream. In Isaiah, the prince of peace. In Jeremiah, the weeping prophet. In Lamentations, the cry for Israel. In Ezekiel, he's the call from sin. In Daniel, he's the stranger in the fire. In Hosea, he is forever faithful. In Joel, he's the Spirit's power. In Amos, he's the arms that carry us. In Obadiah, he's the Lord, our Savior. In Jonah, he's the great missionary. In Micah, the promise of peace. In Nahum, he's our strength and our shield. In Habakkuk and Zephaniah, he's pleading for revival. In Haggai, he restores the lost heritage. In Zechariah, he is our fountain. In Malachi, he is the sun of righteousness rising with healing in his wings. In Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, he is God, man, Messiah. In the book of Acts, he's the fire from heaven. In Romans, he's the grace of God. In 1 and 2 Corinthians, he's the power of love. In Galatians, he's the freedom from the curse of sin. In Ephesians, he's our glorious treasure. In Philippians, he's the servant's heart. In Colossians, he's the Godhead Trinity. In 1 and 2 Thessalonians, he is our coming King. In 1 and 2 Timothy and Titus and Philemon, he's our mediator and our faithful pastor. In Hebrews, he's the everlasting covenant. In James, he's the one who heals the sick. In 1 and 2 Peter, he is our shepherd. In 1, 2, 3 John, and in Jude, he's the lover coming for his bride and church. In Revelation, he is the King of kings and Lord of lords. He is the Prince of Peace, the Son of Man, the Lamb of God, the great I Am. He is Alpha and Omega. He is God. He is Savior. He's the Lord. He is King. And he is better than anything the world has to offer. Church, our hope has a name. Our peace has a name. Our love has a name. And our joy has a name. And that name is what, church? Jesus.